So today is the day of practical application, and in particular we need to recall some details about the river routing and reservoir routing. This is actually a lecture that we had some days ago, about 15, so we need to recall first of all the details of the model, and then we try to make a practical application. So we will try to implement a kind of script that we need to use in order to solve this problem. And in order to understand better what I intend for practical application, I repeat a sketch that we have seen some days ago. So in particular, we have a kind of river with an outlet in a lake, and this lake have a kind of hydraulic structure, something like that. Hydraulic structure. That can convey the water discharge in a downstream river. So actually, in the upstream river, we have a hydrograph that we can call QU. Then, above the hydraulic structure, we have a kind of outlet water discharge, and downstream we can write something, water discharge that we indicate with QD. The only thing that we know is the hydrograph that is flowing, we can write here. So, an hydrograph that is flowing in a section that we can call S1. So, this is known. Oh, sorry, known. So, the problem is, first of all, to compute the QE in this section that we can call S2. Then we need to compute the hydrograph that is flowing in the section at the hydraulic structure that we can call S3. And then again, we want to compute the water discharge, actually the hydrograph, so the water discharge as a function of time that is flowing at the downstream section that we call S4. So the problem is to compute the water discharge here, QD, as a function of the time. When for a given hydrograph at the section S1. So we need first of all to propagate the hydrograph, the flood wave, up to the section S2. And here we need to solve the so-called problem river flooding, river routing. Then we need to compute the transformation of the hydrograph due to the presence of the lake. And here we can call the phenomenon as the reservoir flooding. And then again, to propagate the hydrograph up down to the section S4. That again is a river routing. So we need to do a lot of things. Actually, we know the inflow, so we know the QI, we can call it Q upstream, QU, but also we know some characteristics, some features of the lake. In particular, we know the elevation, sometimes called stage, area curve, but also we need to know the stage discharge curve of the hydraulic structure curve. So we need to know some features of the lake. In other words, the volume of water that can be stored in the lake, but also the function that describes the relationship between the water depth at the hydraulic structure and the discharge that is flowing through the hydraulic structure. Actually, we can make a kind of zoom of the hydraulic structure that is something like that. So you can understand that if we have a free surface elevation into the lake, this is the lake, and this is downstream, of course, downstream. We can write a kind of relationship able to estimate the water discharge as a function of this water depth that we can call zeta spillway, just for example. And we know that the outlet discharge through this kind of structure is equal to a kind of parameter for the length, and this is the length, so the other, this is the length of the spillway, times zeta s, the square root of 2 g zeta s, where actually zeta s is equal to the difference of the elevation of the free surface, that is this one, and the elevation of the spillway. We can call this elevation as zeta hydraulic structure minus zeta hs. So zeta s is actually this water depth. So the difference between the elevation of the free surface into the lake and the elevation of the upper part of the hydraulic structure. So this is the water depth thanks the water depth at the hydraulic structure. And this is the stage discharge curve. Discharge curve. So this is our first information that we can get from the problem at hand. So we need, first of all, to understand if we can have this hydrograph. And the answer is yes, we can have it, but we cannot know now how the hydrograph can be computed. This is a topic of the next lectures. Whilst we can propagate the hydrograph down to the section S2 by means of the river looting model, then we need to propagate the hydrograph to the lake, and again we need to propagate the hydrograph down to the section S4. Quindi il problema è: nota la portata in ingresso in una certa sezione che qui ho chiamato S1, calcolare qual è la sezione in S4. Questo è un po' il concetto. Dobbiamo calcolare qual è la sezione, qual è la portata, o meglio, l'onda di piena, come si dice, in corrispondenza di una sezione posta a valle, nota una sezione posta a monte. Quindi dobbiamo effettuare una serie di operazioni. La prima è quella che va sotto il nome, come vedete qui, di river routing, se volete la propagazione dell'onda di piena in un fiume, quindi dove la dinamica è importante. Qui possiamo scrivere dynamics cannot be neglected. Mentre, quindi innanzitutto dobbiamo propagare l'idrogramma di piena in un fiume, quindi laddove la dinamica non può essere trascurata. Poi dobbiamo propagare l'onda di piena attraverso un lago. Come potete immaginare, come abbiamo ripetuto più volte, qui la superficie libera è sostanzialmente orizzontale, il che vuol dire che la dinamica non è importante, e quindi in questo caso possiamo trascurare la dinamica del problema, quindi qui potremmo scrivere dynamics can be neglected, can be neglected, quindi può essere trascurata la dinamica. Per poi, infine, ripetere l'operazione che già abbiamo fatto a monte, che è quella di propagare la portata in uscita da questo, che è uno sfioratore nella sostanza, fino alla sezione S4. Sezione S4 che potrebbe essere quella di una sezione che passa attraverso, che si trova in corrispondenza ad esempio di un centro urbano, e quindi dobbiamo valutarne la pericolosità di alluvione, come abbiamo detto l'altra volta. So, we need to perform a series of operations. First of all, we need to implement something that is able to solve the problem of river routing. Actually, sometimes we called also this phenomenon as flood routing. Then we need to solve the problem of the reservoir routing, so the hydrograph that propagates in the presence of a lake, and then again a river routing down to the section S4. Section S4 that can be located within an urban center. So we need to understand if the maximum value of the water discharge is compatible with the section into a town, just for example. So we need of this information just to understand the value of the hazard. Actually, the hydraulic hazard. So this is the motivation of these computations. Now, up to now, we have talked about the river routing, the reservoir routing, the river routing again in the downstream part of the river. We have talked about the stage discharge curve. We have talked about the elevation, the stage area curves related to the lake, but we need to recall also the theory. So just to recall something about our past lectures, we recall that the river routing, as you can see here, can be solved by means of this equation. This equation can be read as follows: the downstream water discharge, so this is the downstream water discharge at the near future, so this is the time. So in the PEDIS we have the type of water discharge, and here we have the time. So we have Q, water discharge, PEDIS, where. And in the APIS when. So here we have the time, and here we have the location. So this relationship is able to provide with the values, the value of the downstream discharge at the time I plus 1 as a function of the incoming water discharge. Indeed, the pedis is different. Here we have I and here we have U. At the near future now, but also as a function of the downstream discharge, as you can see here, this pedis is the same of this one, in known now. So this is known now. Actually, we have also three parameters, and these three parameters, C0, C1, and C2, can be computed with these equations. In these equations, we have the time step, and this is a parameter of the problem. Time step also here, 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 and here. But as also as a function of two parameters, k and k. Here k can be, you can see here that k can be computed as the distance between the sections in which we are computing the water discharge, actually the hydrograph. So if we look at a river, here we have S1 and here we have S2. We know the water discharge here, so we know all the water discharge for each time. Then the distance from S1 to S2 is called delta X. Cm is a measure of the celerity of the water discharge, or better, of the hydrograph, that can be computed as a parameter that is equal to about 5 over 3, and a mean velocity of the flow. So, by using this relationship, we can estimate the celerity. By means of the estimation of this celerity, we can estimate the parameter k. Then we know the value needed to compute C0, C1, and C2. But we know we need also the value of k that can be computed by means of this relationship. If you remember, this method is called the Muskingum-Kunge method. That is a kind of practical application of the kinematic method needed to solve the governing equation, that is this one, the continuity equation, in which the volume is a function of both the incoming water discharge, but also of the outlet water discharge. So this relationship, this slide of this presentation, is the solution of this equation as provided of this equation, or better, these equations, as provided by the Muskingum-Kunge method. So, we need to compute these three parameters, C0, C1, and C2. In order to compute the values of these three parameters, we need to know the time step, but we can know the time step because this is a parameter of the problem. We need to know the values of the parameters k and k. The parameters k is related to the propagation of the flooding of the flood wave, and can be estimated by means of the results of the kinematic method. So we need to know the distance between the section and the celerity of the hydrograph. Then we can estimate the value of k. And then we need also to estimate the value of k. The value of k that again can be estimated by means of this relationship. As you can understand, we need to perform some computations in order to solve this problem. So we need to start and try to understand what we are doing. Prego. Assolutamente sì. Sì, certo, delta T è quella che noi chiamiamo la risoluzione temporale. Quindi è un parametro del problema. Tra un po' vedremo nella pratica che cosa vuol dire questa risoluzione temporale. Però tu immaginati che quando io dico che è nota questa portata, o meglio ancora, quest'onda di piena, in realtà non è vero che è nota sempre come una linea, ma è nota in corrispondenza di una serie di punti. Il che vuol dire che posso andare qui e ve lo faccio vedere qui. In realtà, quando io dico che è nota la portata in ingresso, quindi è nota la portata in ingresso in funzione del tempo, e vi disegno questa, immaginate una cosa del genere, in realtà non è vero che noi conosciamo questa linea. Noi conosciamo il valore della portata in alcuni istanti. Non so, vi disegno qua. Quindi c'è qualcuno che ci suggerisce come calcolare. Come vi ho detto, come calcolare questa portata lo sapremo tra qualche tempo, perché vedremo anche come si calcolano queste portate. In realtà noi queste portate le conosciamo per punti, non le conosciamo sempre. E questa differenza è proprio il delta T. Quindi, niente, quindi in generale, giusto per continuare, io conosco diciamo la portata nel generico istante T che è uguale a D per delta T. Così qui I è uguale a 0, quindi T è uguale a 0. Quando T è uguale a 1, qui I è uguale a 1, quindi T è uguale a delta T. Al generico TI il tempo è uguale a I delta T. So delta T is the time step in which I know the inflow water discharge, the inflow hydrograph, and it is the same time step that we need to use to know also the downstream water discharge, T. Again, we cannot know this continuous line, but we know this water discharge at certain times. And again, here and here we have a time step equal to delta T. So delta T is a parameter of the problem that because we can select the values of delta T. Delta T can be, just for example, 5 minutes, just as an example, so 600 of seconds. So we can decide to get the known hydrograph with a given time step, and the same time step is the time step that temporal resolution, if you want, in which we know the solution. Ok? Ho risposto. Niente. So, let's try to understand how we can solve the problem. So, this is the model. So, this is the tools that we can use to solve the problem. Let's try to understand which are the elemental steps that we need to perform in order to get the solution. This is the question now. So we need to start from, first of all, get the incoming hydrograph. So this is hydrograph. This is the first step. In other words, we need to know the inlet water discharge. So we know QI, QI for every time. Then select the correct, not the correct, select the time step. The time step. Delta T. So we need to select a value for delta T, as I said before, 5 minutes, 600 of seconds, just for example. Then we need, if we come back here, to evaluate key. So let's start. We estimate of key. But key is equal to 1 over 2. If we look here, 1 minus Q over Cm, the celerity, the width of the river, the bed slope of the river, and again the distance between the two sections, the time step. So we need also here select the spatial step, that is delta x, so the distance between the two sections we are looking at. In order to estimate the value of key, we need to estimate the value of Q. Estimate of Q. But actually, this is a kind of measure of the water discharge. Indeed, the water discharge changes with time. So we have not only one value of the water discharge. Indeed, if I change the blackboard, the only thing that we know about the water discharge is the Q, the incoming Q. Just for example, we can write this one. This is a maximum value of the incoming water discharge, but also we can realize that the water discharge changes as the time elapses. So we have not only one value of the water discharge. So we can define a kind of mean water discharge, something like that. So this QM is the average water discharge during the hydrograph. So here we need to compute the mean water discharge, and we can identify some relationship in order to select the correct value of the mean water discharge. Then we need to estimate B. B is the width of the river. You have to understand that in this case we are not looking at the details of the hydraulics, but we are getting a kind of an order of magnitude of what is happening during the flood wave propagation. So the width of the river can be estimated also by means of a map. So we can go to a QGIS map and estimate the mean, of course, the mean value of the river width. Again, we need to estimate the value of the slope of the bed, and also in this case we can resort to a kind of digital elevation model of the terrain and so on. So we can estimate in some way also the slope of the bottom. And finally, because we all we have already defined delta x. Indeed, we need also to estimate the celerity, 3.4. Estimate of the celerity of the flooding wave. But the flooding wave is equal to m and a measure of the average velocity. Now, 3.4.1, m is equal, more or less, to 5 over 3. Whilst the u can be estimated as a first rough estimation by means of the normal flow equation. So I go here. What I mean that if we write the normal flow equation, we know that this is the equation that is able to describe the normal flow. Now, if the river is wide, actually, the hydraulic radius is more or less equal to the water depth. Then Q is equal to Ks, the width of the river, times the water depth, and this is omega. The hydraulic radius can be approximated to the water depth, power 2 over 3, the slope of the bed, power 1 over 2. Then here we can write Ks, b, y, 5 over 3, eb, power 1 over 2. 5 over 3 comes from this one, 1 plus 2 over 3. Then a measure of the water depth can be estimated by means this relationship. B, eb, 1 over 2, power 3 over 5. So this is a kind of measure of the water depth occurring during the flood propagation. Pay attention to the fact that this is not the actual water depth, but it is an estimation of the water depth. It is a kind of averaged water depth during the phenomenon. If we know this measure, we can also know that U, that is equal to Q over omega, that it is equal, then Q over BYM. So we, from this relationship, we know the water depth, or better, a measure of the water depth. In this case, we have a measure of the flow, the current velocity. Again, this is a mean value of the water discharge. This is, again, the width of the river. And this is the estimation that we can get from this formulation. So here we have UM. If we come back, here we have UM. Then we can compute also the celerity that we need to compute key. Then, if we come back again to the presentation, we need to compute also the value of k, this one. So, estimate of k, that is equal to delta x over cm, but we know cm because we have already estimated it, but also we have selected also delta x, so we can estimate k. Then we start is, or better, we start from E equal to 1. Then 6, we compute T as E times delta T. So 7, we need to actually I forgot 5, compute C0, C1 and C2. Indeed, if delta T is known, if key and K is known, we can compute all these three parameters. Then we start the computations, the real computations, so we can give the value of I equal to 1. Then we compute the time, that is I delta times delta T, and then we can compute the downstream water discharge at the time T is equal to C0 Q upstream at the time T minus delta T plus C1 Q upstream at the time T plus C2 Q downstream that we know at the time T. Okay? Then we write E is equal E plus 1. Then time is equal to I times delta T. Then if T is lower of the duration of the simulation, then repeat from 7, actually from 8. Else the computation finish. Okay, so up to the final time we need to repeat these computations, updating the time. So this is the more or less the pseudo code. So we can call this one as pseudo code. And now I switch to Italian just to repeat the concepts. Quindi dobbiamo, avete capito che questa non è ancora un programma, non è ancora la soluzione del problema, ma è, come dire, la scomposizione di un'operazione elementare di tutte le cose che dobbiamo fare. Quindi al punto 1 la prima cosa che facciamo è prendere da qualche parte l'ideogramma in ingresso. Quindi l'ideogramma in ingresso QI è noto per qualsiasi istante di tempo. A questo punto dobbiamo fissare la risoluzione temporale, che a titolo di esempio può essere la stessa risoluzione temporale della portata d'ingresso, e la distanza tra le due sezioni, o meglio, tra la sezione di monte in cui conosciamo la portata e la sezione di valle in cui la vogliamo conoscere. A questo punto entriamo nel metodo di Muskingum-Kunge. E per applicare il metodo di Muskingum-Kunge dobbiamo calcolare il parametro chi e il parametro K. Il parametro chi è fornito dalla relazione che vedete qui nel punto 3, da questa qui che vedete scritta qui. Per calcolare questa abbiamo bisogno di una Q, abbiamo bisogno di una celerità media, abbiamo bisogno della larghezza del fiume, abbiamo bisogno della pendenza e abbiamo bisogno del delta X, che però abbiamo già fissato. Ora, il primo problema viene già nella definizione della portata, perché se stiamo parlando di un idrogramma vuol dire che la portata cambia nel tempo. Se cambia nel tempo non esiste un solo valore della portata. E allora, con questo intento, ho fatto questo grafico che abbiamo visto alla fine, in cui osservando che la portata non rimane costante nel tempo, abbiamo bisogno comunque di avere una sorta di rappresentante della portata. E quindi una buona rappresentante potrebbe essere, ad esempio, la portata media, che qui ho fatto graficamente. Dal punto di vista pratico, questa portata media può essere stimata con diversi, diciamo, con diverse tecniche. Potrebbe essere la media integrale, oppure potrebbe essere la portata massima diviso 2, una stima forse un po' rozza, ma comunque vi dà un ordine di grandezza. Quindi il primo problema, come vedete, è scegliere, identificare qual è il rappresentante della portata. Poi dobbiamo stimare la larghezza del fiume, però per fare questo, siccome non stiamo entrando nei dettagli dell'idraulica, ma se volete questo è più un argomento idrologico, che poi vedremo un po' più nel dettaglio che cosa differenzia l'idrologia dall'idraulica, però nella sostanza qui non stiamo entrando nel dettaglio di quello che sta succedendo nel fiume, ma stiamo valutando a grande scala come si propaga un idrogramma di piena. Quindi anche in questo caso possiamo andare su una mappa, usare un software tipo QGIS oppure andare addirittura su Google Earth e valutare qual è la larghezza media, ovviamente, del fiume che stiamo studiando, o meglio, di cui stiamo studiando, in corrispondenza del quale stiamo studiando la propagazione di un idrogramma di piena. La stessa cosa dicasi anche per la pendenza del fondo. La pendenza del fondo che qui abbiamo indicato con IB viene fuori, ad esempio, da un'analisi di un modello digitale del terreno, quello che chiamiamo il DEM, oppure addirittura da un rilievo del fiume. Diciamo che in qualche maniera è possibile valutare quanto vale questa pendenza. E quindi ci siamo. Come dire, abbiamo stimato Q, l'abbiamo stimata, IB l'abbiamo stimata, B l'abbiamo stimata, delta X già ce l'avevamo, rimane la celerità media, ricordatevi sempre questo concetto del medio perché non stiamo entrando nel dettaglio, con cui si propaga questa onda di piena. E sappiamo che nell'ambito del metodo di Masking-Cancunge la celerità media è data dal prodotto di un coefficiente che banalmente può essere posto uguale a 5 terzi, moltiplicato la velocità media della corrente. E qui diventa un problema perché come facciamo a stimare la velocità media della corrente in un fiume in cui la portata sta cambiando nel tempo? Il problema è molto complicato, ma non vogliamo entrare così nel dettaglio e quindi possiamo in linea di principio utilizzare l'equazione del moto uniforme. E questa equazione del moto uniforme, che forse ho scritto ok, che è quella che vediamo qui all'inizio di questa lavagna. E nell'ipotesi che il fiume sia molto largo, per cui il raggio idraulico è circa uguale alla profondità, possiamo ricavare, applicando l'equazione del moto uniforme, una stima dell'ordine di grandezza della profondità della corrente. Perché sto dicendo tutte queste cose? Perché in realtà non è la profondità con cui avviene il deflusso, anche perché stiamo usando il metodo, l'equazione del moto uniforme, qui stiamo in moto vario, quindi sicuramente non è questa la profondità, ma dà un ordine di grandezza. Quindi possiamo stimarci l'ordine di grandezza della profondità attraverso la quale possiamo stimarci un ordine di grandezza della velocità della corrente, come vedete da queste relazioni. Motivo per cui possiamo stimarci attraverso questa relazione, un ordine di grandezza della celerità dell'onda di piena. Fatto questo, non ci rimane nient'altro che stimare anche il valore di K, perché il valore di chi a questo punto può essere calcolato senza grossi problemi, visto che è noto anche questo, e quindi abbiamo sia il valore di K sia il valore di chi che servono per calcolare C0, C1 e C2. A questo punto, da questo punto in poi, parte il vero e proprio metodo di Masking-Cancunge. Quindi ci mettiamo all'istante iniziale I uguale 1, per cui T è uguale a I volte delta T, quindi al primo passo. Ci stiamo chiedendo che cosa succede per t uguale a delta t e calcoliamo la portata a valle, questa QD, nell'istante t, quindi in t uguale delta t, in funzione della portata a monte all'istante precedente. Alla portata a valle, qui scusate, sorry, no, this is correct. Minus delta t, minus delta t, and here we have minus delta t, because we know this, this value. Quindi dobbiamo calcolare la portata a valle nell'immediato futuro, cioè in t uguale delta t, in funzione di quello che c'è adesso a monte, di quello che c'è adesso a valle, e questo anche lo conosciamo, e anche questo lo conosciamo, e in funzione della portata a monte, che vi ricordo conosciamo sempre nell'immediato futuro, cioè in t uguale delta t. Cioè tutte queste portate noi le conosciamo, c0, c1 e c2 le conosciamo, e quindi abbiamo calcolato la portata a valle nell'istante delta t. Poi andiamo un passetto avanti, se qui io do uguale 1, qui diventa 2, t uguale 2 per delta t. E ci chiediamo, ma siamo arrivati alla fine del fenomeno che vogliamo studiare? T max è una sorta di durata della simulazione. Quindi se 2 volte delta t è inferiore alla durata della simulazione, allora ripartiamo dal punto 8. In questo caso il tempo non è più 1 delta t, ma uguale a 2 delta t. Quindi questo diventa delta t, questo diventa t 2 delta t e questo diventa delta t. Ma questo è il risultato del passo precedente, quindi lo conosciamo. Quindi possiamo ripetere questa operazione fino a che non arriviamo alla fine. So this is a kind of pseudocode. Actually we can also translate this pseudocode in a different way, that is the flowchart. Prego. E che problema? No, ma la durata della simulazione. Tu immaginati, ok, quindi diciamo quando il fenomeno si è, se vuoi, Tmax sta qua. Esatto, praticamente questo. So, this is the duration of the simulation. Niente. So we can try to translate the pseudocode in a better way by means of a flowchart. So we can start with an ellipse, and we must end. So we can get who upstream. And I use a kind of this. So when I use this shape, I'm saying that we are getting something, we are reading something. And also, so we need to get the hydrograph, the upstream hydrograph, the value of delta t and the value of delta x. So we need to read from a file or from somewhere the hydrograph, so the time variation of the upstream water discharge, the value of the time step, and the distance between the sections. Then we need to compute CM. We can get also the value of the river width and the value of the bed slope. So these are all parameters of the problem. Then we can compute in order. We need to compute YM. Then we can compute U. Then we can compute CM. Of course, we need also to estimate a mean value of the water discharge. Then we can compute T, and then we can compute. We need to compute all these parameters. Then we compute the parameters C0, C1 and C2. And it is not so complex to make this computation. Then we start. We get E is equal to 1. E is equal to 1. And I use this shape. Then I compute T is equal I times delta T. Then we compute Q downstream at the time T. And then we increase, we go here, increase the value of I. So we are going farther in the future. We compute T again. T is equal to E delta T. And then we ask, is T lower than the duration of the simulation? This is a question, so we need to use this shape. If the answer is yes, we need to go here, yes. If the answer is no, we have finished. No. So we need to perform this loop up to the end of the simulation. Once the simulation is finished, then we can go outside of this loop and we go to the end of the script, if you want. Quindi, in altra maniera, possiamo scrivere il diagramma di flusso. Ovviamente qui sono stato un po' meno dettagliato. Però dobbiamo prendere e leggere da qualche parte la portata a monte, il delta T, il delta X, la larghezza del fiume e la pendenza del fondo. Quindi questi sono tutti i parametri. Quindi dobbiamo calcolare il valore medio della portata, il valore della misura della profondità, una misura della corrente, della velocità della corrente, ovviamente media, un valore della celerità media, il valore di chi e il valore di K, e quindi possiamo calcolare C0, C1 e C2. Una volta che abbiamo fatto questo, partiamo. Quindi fissiamo U uguale 1, quindi vuol dire che stiamo definendo l'istante temporale in cui vogliamo calcolare le cose, e calcoliamo la portata a valle, nella sezione di valle, che abbiamo indicato con QD all'istante T. Una volta che abbiamo calcolato questo, incrementiamo il valore di I, il che vuol dire che stiamo incrementando il valore di T, e poi ci chiediamo, ma è finita la simulazione? Cioè, il tempo è inferiore alla durata della simulazione? Cioè, devo fare ancora altri conti? Se la risposta è sì, cioè devo fare altri conti, riparto calcolando QD all'istante T. Notate che questo T non è più quello di prima con I uguale 1, perché io ho aumentato I, e quindi T è aumentato di un delta T. Quindi questa formula darà un risultato diverso. C0, C1 e C2 sono gli stessi, ma la portata a monte e la portata a valle nell'istante precedente è diversa. Quindi il risultato sarà diverso. E poi andiamo ancora avanti, incrementiamo il tempo di un ulteriore delta T. Quindi stiamo dentro questo ciclo, il loop, come si dice, fino a che non siamo arrivati alla fine della simulazione. Quando siamo arrivati alla fine della simulazione, allora usciamo dal ciclo e vuol dire che abbiamo finito. Now we need to translate this idea, because this is an idea, into a script. And then, as usual, we can go here in the work folder and we can write something. We need to create a Python file. We can flood floating dot py. I changed the extension of the file. I right click on the mouse, open with code, and Microsoft Visual Studio Code starts. Then we need to translate what we have written into this flowchart, or if you want, in this pseudocode here, into a script. As you know, a script again starts with a kind of comment about the aim of the script. I increase the font size. Okay. I can write this script solves the river flooding, the river routing and reservoir routing. Then we need to import the needed packages modules as you want. So as usual, we import NumPy and we import the package matplotlib as plt dot pyplot. By SNP. Then we start a part of the script with the parameters of the problem, and then we start with the core of the script, that is the river routing. So come back to the blackboard. Get the incoming hydrograph. So the first part is point one. Get the upstream hydrograph. I prepared a file that you can see here for the hydrograph. So I prepared an external file that I called hydrograph.txt, in which the first column is the time in hours, and the second column is the water discharge in cubic meter per second. So we need to read the numbers contained into this file, and it is not so difficult to queue up stream equal to np load txt and the name of the file, hydrograph. So we are using a new function of the module NumPy. Indeed, when we use np, we are referring to NumPy. So load txt, as we can read also here, load data from a text file. Each row in the text file must have the same number of values. Indeed, here, the numbers in the file are always two for each row of the file, so we can use this one. And as usual, here, we can again add this function to our presentation. So we can add a slide and we can write data equal np load txt file.txt. So this function reads the numbers into the contained into the file named file.txt. So this is a really fast method aimed to read numbers from a file. Of course, this file must be simple. And when I say that the file must be simple, I mean that the number of values in each row must be the same, whatever the row we are looking at. So, se il file ha lo stesso numero di valori per ogni riga, posso usare questa funzione. The values are stored into the variable data. So I can access the value contained in the file.txt by accessing the variable data. Here, instead of data, I used the name qUpstream. I can write from file. Okay, I can also try to print upstream. Sorry, qUpstream from file. If I execute the script, I should see the values contained into the file. We need to. So, this is the time and this is the water discharge. If we come back, this is the time in hours and this is the water discharge. So here we have 0, 3.06, 11.9. Indeed, if we go here, we have 3 point something, 11 point something. So these numbers are the numbers that are read from the file, directly from the file. Actually, the first column is the time. So we can write up stream time is equal to the first column of this variable. How we can get only the first column? By using this kind of statement. So we need to use the name of the variable that we used to read the numbers from the file. Then all the rows and the first column. Remember that Python starts to count from zero and not one. So the first column is the column with index equal to zero. And the water discharge, I copy here, Q is the second column, so it is one. So we can write here, instead of printing this variable, so the whole file, only the first column and then the second one. We can write here qUpstream Q. If I run the script, I should say only one column, not two. We have the two. Okay, so this is the second column. And this is the first one. As you can, I can try to make thinner the font size. Then this is the time in hours, and this is the water discharge. Pay attention that the time actually must be expressed in seconds, not in hours. So we need to multiply the time that is in hour in seconds. So we can write here, read the hydrograph from the file. Here, this one extract the times and express them in seconds. And the second column is expressed in cubic meter per second, so it is okay. We can make a kind of plot of what we have read. So here we have Q upstream time and Q upstream Q, PLT show. So in this case we have on the abscissa the time expressed in second and in the y-axis the water. We can write simply Q meter cubic meter per second. We can also switch on the grid line style equal minus minus. Okay, we can run the script and then we should, okay, get the plot. Should, okay. And this is the hydrograph. Here you can see that we have the water discharge, here we have the time, and this is the hydrograph. In order to understand that we don't know actually the water discharge in each time, for every time, but only in some instance, we can use this one. So here I'm saying that the plot should be built with a line, but with a marker, with a dot, at the time in which I know the water discharge. Just here, font size, font weight, just to make to improve the quality of the plot. I run it again, and as you can realize, we have the same plot of before, but now we understand that the water discharge is not known for every time, but only with a time step of 900 of seconds. So 900 is a quarter of hour. So we know the water discharge only with a time resolution of a quarter of hour, every 15 minutes, not for every time. So delta T, actually, delta T, we can write here dt is 900. Actually, we can write here in the parameters dt is equal to 900 of seconds. So this is the time step in seconds. Okay. So we have done the point one. The point two actually is the selection of the time step delta t and the spatial step. So we can write here point two dt and dx. Dx can be just for example 2,000 of meters, 2 kilometers. Spatial step meters. So this is the distance between between the sections. Okay. Now, just to check, this method works only if delta t is lower than delta x over the mean values of the celerity. So Once we have estimated the values of the mean celerity, we need to check if delta t is lower than the distance between the sections over the mean value of the celerity. So we need to check. This is a kind of stability criterion. This the meaning of this criterion is out of the scope of this lecture, but there is a theoretical motivation. There is theoretical motivations in this stability criterion. Sorry. Then we need to estimate k. So we need to start with the point 2. Estimate of k. So point, oh, this is point 3. Point 3 point dot 1. Estimate of q, or better, the mean value of the water discharge. So estimate of QM. Very simply, we can estimate the mean water discharge as the maximum inflowing incoming water discharge, a half of the maximum value of the water discharge that is coming from upstream. And Q max is equal to NP dot max Q upstream Q, a new function that is rather simple. NP dot max, given a vector, and the vector, the array is Q upstream Q, that contains all the values of the incoming water discharge, this function gets the maximum value. So we can switch to this presentation again, and we can value equal np dot max this function extracts the maximum value of the array named array and store it in the variable value. So this function can be useful and stores it in the variable. Can be useful to extract the maximum value of an array. Then, so we have done, we can switch to the green one. One, we have done. We have done this, we have done this. Estimate, actually, this is a kind of parameter. Then here we can write 0.3.2. Bm is equal, just for example, 100 meters. So this is the river width in meters. And also, point 3.3, so we have done this one, estimate the slope of the bed, EB 001, the bed slope, and the bed slope, the slope is dimensionless. So these are parameters, also this one. Then, and then we can stop for minutes, we can estimate this one. In order to estimate this one, we have this, we have this, we have this. We forgot to define also Ks, so we can write here Ks is equal to Strickler coefficient meter 1 over 3 over seconds. Okay. Then we can compute ym. Ym, if we come back here, we are here, 3.4. 0.3.4. So first of all, we need to write m is equal to 5 over 3. Dot 0, 3, dot 0. And this is m. Then we need to compute the um, the velocity. The velocity can be computed with this relationship. So we compute ym, that is qm over ks times the width of the river b times the bed, the slope bed power 1 over 2, and all these ratio and p power 3 over 5. This is bm. Okay, bm. Increase the font size. So this relationship, this is the measure of the water depth. So this is QM, this one, over KS B and slope of the bed power 1 over 2, this one. Then we need to compute UM, and UM is equal to the water discharge QM over YM times BM. So we have computed a measure of the current velocity. Then we can compute CM, that is equal to M times UM. So we used this relationship, this one, again, another arrow. So the point 3.4. Okay? So just to CM equal meter per second dot format CM. So we can see in the terminal the values of the severity. We stop, we run the script, we wait. So the hydrograph, the flood wave, propagates with a severity of about 2 meters per second. Okay, then now, once the values of CM is known, we need to estimate K and key. So we need to estimate key, and then we stop. So key is equal to 1 over 2, 1 minus QM over CM, over CM times, and I write this one, B, EB, delta X, BM, EB times DX. Indeed, DX is this one. And K is equal to dx over cm. We can write here also print key equal format key and key is equal format key. We can try to run the script and we can key float object is not full. Oh, okay, I forgot times, and then we should have the values of the parameters. So we have key that it is equal to 0.34 and k is about 1000. Okay, this is second minus one, and this is without dimensionless. Then we need to compute C0 equal, C1 equal, and C2 equal, but we will write the relationship after a brief pause. Now we need to write the relationship aimed to estimate, or better, to compute the values of the three parameters needed to update the solution, so C0, C1 and C2. So we need to go to the presentation here and we need to write these three relationship. So C0 is delta T. So the first one is delta T minus 2 times K times key over dt times, plus 2 times K times 1 minus key. And this is the first one. The second one is more or less, is very similar to the first one, but the sign at the numerator. So we can copy this one, with a plus here. And then the last one is similar also, but with a minus here, minus here, minus dt, but also here we have 2k times 1 minus key. So 2k times 1 minus key. And we can write also here C0, C1, C2, C0, C1, and C2 without, and here we have C0, C1, and C2. We can run the script. We can run the script and we should see the values of C0, C1 and C2. C1, C0, as you can see here, C0, C1 and C2 equal to 0.08 and so on, 0.708 and so on, and C2 is 0.209 and so on. So we have computed the values of C0, C1 and C2. Now we need to perform the call loop of the script. As you can see here, we have implemented up to this point. Then we need to perform this loop. So this is a kind of loop. Let's try to make only the first one. So we can write E equal to 1 time equal E times dt. So we have write this one and this one. Then we need to compute the new value of the downstream water discharge. So we can try to write something like that. Q downstream mu is equal to Q incoming. If we look at where is the, here we are. This is new. This is old. Or we better. We can write this as now. This is before. This is now. And this is before. Okay, so we can write here QD now is equal to C0 times Q upstream before before plus C1 times QU now plus C2 times Q downstream before. Of course, as you can see here, the script does not know the values of Q upstream before, Q upstream now, Q downstream before. So we need to write here something like Q before is equal to something, Q now is equal to something, Q downstream before is equal to something. Now we can write what we mean by now and what we mean before. So now is time. So now is IDT. Indeed, now is T. Now is T, and T is equal to I times DT. So now is time. Whilst before is time minus dt. Or if you want, we can write the time now or the time of before. But also we can write the index of now and the index of before. The index on now is I. The index of before is I minus 1. Okay? Now, Q upstream before is the, we need to come back here, Q upstream time and Q upstream Q. This variable is a vector, is an array with numbers for each delta t. So actually Q upstream before is Q upstream Q before I, and now is now. So just for example, here we have I equal to 1. Let's try to understand better this. We have Q upstream Q. And this is an array. An array is a kind of column of numbers. Okay. So just for example, here we have 0, here we have 3.06, here we have 11 plus dot 92, and so on. Indeed, if we come back to Ci siete? Sì, mi sentite tutti. Ok. If we come back here, if we come back here, we have 0, 3.06, 11.93, and so on. So, Q upstream Q is an array of numbers. So, this is I equal to 0, this is I equal to 1, this is I equal to 2, this is I equal to 3, and so on. Ok? Now, when I say that E is equal to 1, I is equal to 1, I'm saying that now is I, so 1. So, this is now. And before is this one. So, the time of now is idt. The time of before is time minus dt. And the index of now is I. The index of now is I. And the index of before is I minus 1, so this one. So when I write this one, I'm saying that the upstream water discharge before is equal to the values contained into the array Q upstream Q, this column, at the index before. At the index before, but the index before is this one, so this one is the value of the variable that I called QU before. And this one is the number that I called Q now. Okay? The problem is about QD before. Because QD before is should be an array. And actually, it is an array, so I can write Q downstream Q is equal to the Q upstream Q times 0. So we have another vector that we can call Q downstream Q that is equal to the upstream one, is equal, but the numbers are these numbers times 0, so all the numbers are 0. And again, this one is before the first one in this case, then this one is Q downstream before. So I can write here that QD before is Q downstream Q before I. Okay? Q downstream Q times 0. Okay? Now, this is the new value of the downstream water discharge. Actually, this is the downstream Q at now high is equal to QD now. So, by means of this statement, I compute the new value of the downstream water discharge. And then I put it into this number. So this is now So in this case, I am replacing the 0 that is in this array with a new value. And this new value is the result of these new values of the downstream water discharge. So actually, we can write this one. QD now is equal to QD now. And this is cubic meter per second. Let's try to run the script. As you can see, the downstream water discharge is not zero, but it is equal to 2.17 cubic meter per second. Okay? So this is the new updated solution. Now we need, so we come back, if we come back here, we have done this one. So we have done this one, but also this one. Now we need to increase the values of I, and we need to perform this this loop. Actually, we can do something like that. All this one, I copy this one here. All this part of the code, of the script, oh, sorry, must be repeated. So we can write for I in range 0, just for example 10, okay? 2, comma. So I equal, this is starting from 1, equal to, and here I put I, and if I run the script, I run the script. Now we should see 10 computations, not only one. So as you can see, the downstream water discharge is increasing. We can increase this number up to 20. We again run the script. Okay, so the computation is repeated 1, 2, 3, 4, 20 times, actually 19 times. And we can also plot here not only the upstream queue, but also the downstream queue. In this case, okay, the downstream queue is this one. I again, sorry, again repeat the run. As you can see, this in orange is the new, or actually the propagated flood wave 2 kilometers downstream the upstream section. As you can see, the maximum value is a little bit lower than the upstream one. Okay, and of course the orange hydrograph has is delayed with respect to the upstream one. So, the flood wave is propagating. Quindi vedete, il valore massimo è un pochino più piccolo, non molto più piccolo, è poco più piccolo. Ma la cosa più importante è che, vedete che questo arancione è a destra di quello blu, vuol dire che è ritardato rispetto a quello blu, il che è intuitivo. Se io mi metto a valle, l'onda di piena arriva un po' dopo, se volete. Quindi si sta propagando verso valle. Questo è un po' il concetto. We can also increase this one. We can actually, for the length of the water discharge, so the whole hydrograph. So now we are performing the same computation for each, as you can see here, for all the times. And then we can observe that the water discharge is propagating downstream and the maximum value is a little bit decreased with the upstream, with respect to the upstream one. If we increase the value of delta x, just for example, 5 kilometers, we simply change the parameter at the beginning of the script, we should expect that the floodway is propagated further downstream, è propagato un pochino di più verso valle, infatti dovrebbe essere un po' più lontano, e il massimo è ancora un po' più basso. Vedete, se io faccio lo zoom qua, vedete, propagato ancora un po' di più ed è ancora un po' più basso. We can switch again to 10,000 of kilometers. And then again, we can see that the hydrograph is propagating downstream. So the maximum value decreases and the downstream water discharge is delayed. Okay? So if the delta x increases, also this delay increases. Quindi vedete che succede qualcosa di molto diverso rispetto alla laminazione in un lago, che come vedete la diminuzione, the decrease of the maximum value of the water discharge is not so high. Because the dynamics is very important, but the storage is not. Ovviamente, perché questa portata dovrebbe diminuire? Cioè, qual è il motivo per cui la portata diminuisce durante la propagazione? Perché dell'acqua è rimasta nel fiume. Ma questo è un fiume che non ha una capacità di invaso, ha della dinamica, cioè la superficie libera non è orizzontale, se volete, ma il fiume non riesce a trattenere del volume. Infatti, la portata non è tanto più piccola. Semplicemente perché la portata dura un po' di più, l'idrogramma dura un po' di più, infatti se vediamo nella coda qui vedete che dura un po' di più. Quindi vedete che quell'arancione è a destra di quello blu perché la portata, o meglio, l'onda di piena si sta propagando. So, this is our main result. So, if we come back here to the sketch of the problem, if S2 is 10 kilometers, so if S2 is 10 kilometers downstream section S1, we have computed the transformation of the inflow, the incoming hydrograph, this one in a new one, and this is Q, we can call it Q2. This is the time. So we can at the very end write that Q2 is equal to the count Q downstream Q. So, this is the first result. Hydrograph at section S2. Okay? So, this is our first result. So, we can write here QU. Now, we need to perform the computation of the related to the reservoir routing. So here we need to repeat the computation reservoir routing. Okay? And this is not, this cannot be performed with the same, as you know, with the same method. So we need to come back again to the presentation and we need to switch to the reservoir routing. Again, the equation is the same, so the continuity equation, but the volume in this case is a function of only the outlet water discharge. This is the true difference between the river routing and the reservoir routing. This is true if dynamics is neglected. Otherwise, we should retain the dependence of the inlet water discharge. In this case, if dynamics is retained. So in the case of reservoir routing, this one is true. This is only true for river routing. And in this case, we can observe that V is a function of the free surface elevation into the lake. As we have said before, in one actually year, the dynamics can be neglected. Then we can define a function, a relationship between the elevation into the lake and the volume of water contained into the lake. So we are saying that the volume is a function of the free surface elevation into the lake alone, only. So we can write also that the volume, the variation of the volume with respect to the time, is due to the variation, actually, the variation, the volume with respect to the time is equal to the variation of the volume contained into the lake with respect to the free surface elevation into the lake times the free surface elevation into the lake variation with respect to the time. And this one is the so-called fingerprint area of the lake. So if we have a lake, something like that, this is an area, so a plan view area, and this is the fingerprint. Indeed, if we increase the free surface elevation of the zeta w times a, this is the variation of the volume of water contained into the lake. So this is A. It means that this equation can be written in this way. The time variation, the free surface elevation into the lake is equal to the incoming water discharge minus the outlet water discharge over A. Now, if I write here, the incoming water discharge is a function of the time. The outlet water discharge is a function of zeta w, of the free surface elevation into the lake. Indeed, again, if we come back here, in this case, this relationship provide us with the value of the outlet water discharge as a function of zeta s, but zeta s is a function of zeta w, the free surface elevation into the lake, minus a parameter of the problem. This is a parameter of the problem, the elevation of the spillway. So Q outlet is a function of zeta v, A is a function of zeta v. It means that Qi minus Qo over A, that is the right hand side of this equation, this is a function of the time and of the free surface evolution, elevation into the lake. Why we need to write this equation in this form? Because we have a numerical method able to solve this kind of equation, in which we have the time derivative of something equal to a function of the time and of that something, in this case of the free surface elevation into the lake. And as you remember in our past lecture, this is the Runge-Kutta method, this one, Runge-Kutta method. As you can see here, we need to perform the computation of K1 equal to delta t, but we know delta t, times the function, and the function is this one. This is the function, this is the function computed in for zeta w before, so I is equal to before, and I plus 1 is equal to now, as you can see here. Actually, we can write this equation in a different way, actually, with the same rationale that we used before. Zeta w now, or better, at the first time we have I equal to 1, t is equal to I times delta t. Then we can write zeta w at the time t is equal to the zeta w at the time t minus the delta t plus k1 over 6 plus k2 over 3 plus k3 over 3 plus k4 over 6 plus an error that is related to the time step power 4. So it is a rather reliable numerical method. So again, this is now, this is before. And the key of the Runge-Kutta method, this is again Runge-Kutta method, so this is actually the fourth order Runge-Kutta method, relies on the computation of K1, K2, K3, and K4. So we need to compute K1, K2, K3, and K4 as by computing the value of the right hand side of the governing equation with different values of time and different values of the free surface elevation within the lake. So we can try to compute this one. So again, we start. E is equal to 1, okay? So we need to perform computation of K1. We come back here. K1 is equal to delta T, and we can write here K1 is equal to delta T times this function computed with the free surface elevation before and the time before. So we can write this one as RHS, and RHS is equal to Q inlet minus Q outlet over the area. As you can see here, the script does not know the values of QI and the values of QO and the values of A. So we need to solve this trouble, this problem. So QI is equal, we can switch here, and we can understand that, okay, here, not here. QI is a function of the time. So we can switch here, we can write a comment. QI is a function of the time only. As K1 is computed before, as you can see here, this is the time that is related to before, we need to understand, to evaluate the incoming water discharge at the time equal to before. So it is Q2i minus 1, but we can again write now is I, before is I minus 1. So we can write here before I. Pay attention that we use Q2. Q2 is the hydrograph that we computed here. This is Q2. And Q2 is now the incoming water discharge. So here we are using Q2 as the incoming water discharge into the lake at the time before. So T high minus 1. So Q high is okay. Q is a function of zeta V only. Indeed, if we come back here, actually here, and actually here, as you can see here, Q outlet is a function of zeta V, zeta W. And which is this relationship? This one. So, QO, that is a function of zeta W only, is this one. So we need to perform this computation. So first of all, we need to compute the value of zeta S. Zeta S is the water depth. We can actually write, we can call it HS. So it is a kind of water depth. So this is HS. And here is HS and HS. HS, HS. So HS is equal to zeta W minus zeta hydraulic structure. But zeta hydraulic structure is not known. Actually, it is a parameter of the zeta HS. Just for example, 150 meters above sea level, mean sea level. So we can write elevation of the hydraulic structure, actually a spillway. So HS is known here. Zeta W, what is zeta W? If we look at this sketch, zeta W is the free surface elevation into the lake. But the free surface elevation into the lake is the solution of this equation. So it is the solution. Now we can write zeta V is equal to Q2 times 0. So again, coming here, we have an array that we called Q2 with a series of numbers. When this is E equal to 0, this is E I equal to 1, this is before, and this is now. When I write zeta W is equal to Q2 times 0, I'm saying that I have a further array very similar to the first one, but filled with 0. Because I'm taking this array and I am multiplying this array by 0. So here I have 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and so on. This is before, and this is now again. This one, it is not zeta W, whatever the value you want, but before. Indeed, if we come back to the Runge-Kutta method, you can see here that this one is the free surface elevation before. So this one, but this one is now set to 0. Actually, we need to provide also with the initial condition zeta v 0. Just for example, 149.5 initial elevation within the lake. Then, actually, the first value of zeta v, zeta w, is equal to zeta w 0. Okay? So this is HS, but we need to compute actually not zeta HS only, but the value of the outlet water discharge. So Q outlet is equal to mu times L times HS times the square root of 2 times G times HS. This relationship is exactly this one, mu L HS times the square root of 2 times G HS, where G is the gravitational acceleration. Now again, mu is not known by the script, L is not known by the script, G is not known by the script. So we need to put them within the parameters. We can write mu equal to 0.4, We will dedicate a lecture about the estimation of this parameter, so parameter of the spillway. L, 25 meters. This is the width of the spillway. And again, okay, G is equal 9.8065 gravitational acceleration. Okay, gravity acceleration. Gravity acceleration. So we can compute this one. Actually, this statement is not correct. Why does this equation, why this equation is not correct? Because HS could be negative. Indeed, in this case, I had this one. I can have two situations. The first one is when the free surface elevation within the lake, this is zeta w, is lower than this elevation, that is zeta hs. This is the first case. The second case is when the free surface elevation is higher than this elevation, and then in this case a water discharge occurs. So in this case Q outlet is equal to zero. In this case the outlet is actually equal to this one. So when HS equal to zeta W minus zeta HS is lower than zero, Q outlet is equal to zero. When HS is higher than zero, then this is true. Then this is true. So we need to write, if HS is higher than zero, then Q outlet is equal to this relationship. Otherwise, Q is equal to zero. So we perform the computation of the incoming water discharge before. The outlet water discharge by using the spillway equation. Now we need to perform the computation of the fingerprint area. The fingerprint area, if we come back here, is a function, as you can see here, is a function of the free surface elevation only. But we don't know this function, because this function can be obtained only by analyzing the digital elevation model. So we need of some measurements. Actually, I made these measurements and I have a file in which the first column is the free surface elevation and the second column is the extension of the fingerprint area. Quindi l'area della superficie libera vista dall'alto. Non è che ce la possiamo inventare. L'unica cosa che possiamo fare è fare delle misure. Quindi abbiamo bisogno di un modello digitale del terreno e abbiamo bisogno di analizzare questo modello digitale del terreno. Questa analisi già è stata fatta e vi faccio vedere direttamente i risultati. Cioè, nella prima colonna di questo file ci sono le elevazioni, nella seconda colonna di questo file c'è l'estensione espressa in milioni di metri quadrati, quindi se volete in chilometri quadrati, dell'impronta del lago. Come vedete, questo è un lago relativamente piccolo, non arriva neanche a un chilometro quadrato, quindi un piccolo lago. Ma nella sostanza possiamo in linea di principio riferirci al risultato di alcune misure e ottenere queste informazioni. Come vedete, ancora una volta queste informazioni stanno dentro un file, quindi abbiamo bisogno di leggerlo.
We need to read this information. Then we copy this one, and we get the values of fingerprint area as a function of zeta w. Now the file name is fingerprint.txt, and this is not q upstream time, but it will be a zeta w, and this is the elevation, and a extension ext, that is the second column, and we need to multiply for 1 million, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3 dot, in order to have the extension of the fingerprint area expressed in square meter. Okay, now here the area is the area computed with the free surface elevation before, so we are not sure that here we have the correct values of the fingerprint area for each of the free surface elevation that we are computing. So we need to interpolate. How? We can resort to a function of NumPy in which we want to compute the fingerprint area computed at the free surface elevation before. And this new function needs, first of all, the point at which we want to know the value of the function and the known values of the function. So we need this one, a zeta w, and a x. I try to explain better this aspect, and I come here. Let's imagine that we know, so we have an axis in which we have a, and an axis in which we have zeta w. The number into the file can be represented here, something like that. Okay? So this is the function, just for example. Now, if we want to get the value of the area for whatever the zeta w, just for example, this is the zeta w before. As you can understand, I don't know the values of the area, but I can perform a kind of linear interpolation. So this is the correct value. So NP interp get the value in which we want to know zeta v before, in which we want to know the value of the area. And in order to compute this value, it needs the known values zeta w known and the relative area known. So this one, these two, is the coordinate of this point, of all this point, of all this point, but all these points are contained into this file. Then, in the script, the contents of the file is contained into these two variables, the free surface elevation and the extension of the fingerprint. So this is a new function, np.interp. We go to this one, we np.dectorad power arrange zeros load text max, we can copy and we can value, sorry, and we write here interp x xp yp yp. This function interpolates the values of the function x p yp at the point x. The result is stored into the variable value. Okay? Save. So in this case, perform a linear interpolation. Okay? Then it is possible to compute the right-hand side of the equation and then to compute k1. Okay? But this is only the first step. So this is the computation of k1. Let's try to copy this one and copy. Now we need to compute k2. Let's try k2. If we come back here again, not here, but here, we are computing this one in this case, this one in this case. So again, we have delta t dot the function. The function is the right hand side, so f is equal to qi minus qo over a. But this function, we can rewrite here that qi is a function of the time, qo is a function of zeta w, and a is a function of zeta w. Here you can observe that in k2, zeta w is not zeta w before, but zeta w before plus k1 over 2. So, actually, we can write here the new elevation is zeta w before I plus k1 over 2. So this is this one. Zeta elevation before, that is the first term, before, plus k1 over 2. So zeta w before plus k1 over 2. Qe is equal to the function, is a function of the time, but this time is t plus delta t over 2. So the we can write tt is equal to time, we need to go here, time is equal to e times dt, tt, where we are, tt is equal to time plus dt over 2. Now, key, q high, so this one, is the incoming water discharge computed at the time plus the time step, a half of the time step. And if you remember, by means of this one, I have not Yes, okay. I know the incoming water discharge, every delta T. Now I'm asking the value at a half of delta T. So we need to perform again the interpolation. So we come back here. And I write interp at the time with the known values of the incoming water discharge. Now, the values are Q2, so we can write here Q2, but the time is the same time of the incoming water discharge from the very upstream section. So it is this one. This one. So this is the perform a linear interpolation, get the incoming water discharge to get the incoming water discharge at T equal to T plus delta T over 2. Q is a function of zeta v only, so Qi is okay. Now, the outlet water discharge, if we come back again here, is a function of zeta v, but which zeta v? Zeta w before plus k1 over 2, that we called LEV. So, very simply, here we can write LEV minus zeta hs. If HS is higher than zero, the relationship is the same. Then, again, we need to interpolate the fingerprint area. Then the right-hand side is updated and K2 computed. Now we need to compute K3. 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 More or less the same approach. K3, zeta v, zeta w, this one is the zeta w before, now plus k2 over 2. So it simply we can write here k2 over 2. The time is now plus dt over 2. Time is dt is equal to the time plus dt over 2. Okay? I'm looking here. Actually, this is I minus 1. Okay. The remaining part of the script is the same. And then finally, we need to compute K4. K4. If we look at the formulation, the zeta w, if I look, we look here, is equal to the zeta w before plus k3. So here we need to write plus k3, and the time is time plus delta t. Quindi not delta t over 2, but delta t. And this is k4. The new elevation, elevation is equal to the old elevation, that is zeta v w before I plus k1 over 6 plus k2 over 3 plus k3 over 3 plus k4 over 6. This is the new elevation, but the new elevation, if we think about it, is this one. Is this one. This is the new elevation. Is the elevation now. New elevation. Okay? Then, as we have called the new elevation as here, this one, zeta w, it means that zeta w I is equal to new elevation. Now this is the time to leave. Actually, this one started with I equal to 1, but actually we can repeat this one for I in range 1 length Q2. And actually Q outlet is equal to W. So here we built also another vector of 0. Then we can write also that we can perform the computation with the new elevation, so new elevation, and then we can write also I equal to QO, no QO, solution, QO sol, okay, and then we can write also here, so this is Q2 and this is QO sol. With just a run, if it works is okay, otherwise we need to leave.